اللهم الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أشهد أن صلاتي وسلامي على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم. I know I just closed the laptop and the screen is appearing, but it's very distracting to have the laptop open in front of me. So please forgive me for doing that. And I'm sure you can see what was on the screen in your booklets as well. So we've all just come back from lunch, and I know people are still trickling in also after the lunch hour. And after a morning of discussing the importance of moderation, of understanding what it means to moderate, of what our deen tells us moderation is, I want to take a look at what it means to understand that our faith, our deen Islam, is against violence in all elements. The violence that we often think of when equated to the faith of Islam is the violence that media has propagated and has convinced us is related to our faith. A violence against countries, a violence against entire peoples, a violence against cultures, a violence against races, as we heard Imam Zayed speaking earlier. But this is not my Islam, this is not your Islam. This is not the Islam that the Prophet came to teach us about. But sometimes when we get very caught up in the discussion of Islam is against violence, when we get very caught up in the discussion that extremism does not define my faith, we forget to pause for a moment and turn our eyes inward and look at our own selves, our own homes, and at the way that we live our Islam, not just to the outside world, not just to society that surrounds us, not just in government or in politics, but how do we live Islam? How do we counteract the idea of violence? How do we control our own anger and our own rage? And it's difficult to have a conversation about moderation without really first looking at ourselves. As a marriage counselor in Cornerstone, which is a counseling center that I run in New Jersey, it saddens me and it breaks my heart to see that among the numerous difficulties that we work with families to overcome, one of the most frequent situations that we see is domestic violence between Muslim couples. Domestic violence where parents are beating their children, where spouses are beating their spouses, where there is verbal abuse, there is emotional abuse, there is physical abuse. Isn't this violence? And this is where we need to stop and ask ourselves, are we starting with ourselves? Are we looking at our own homes first before trying to go and counter the talking heads on Fox News who tell us your Islam is a violent religion? Are we looking at ourselves first and asking, what can I do in my own home, in my own relationships? Do I live my Islam the way my Prophet has taught me? And until we get to that point where we can look at ourselves and look at our own home and understand that violence does not mean just lifting up an AK-47 and putting a bullet in someone. That's not the only form of violence that exists in our communities or in our society today. Violence exists in that harsh word that you said to your spouse that was unwarranted. Violence exists in putting down your child and telling them they're not good enough, they're not kind enough, they're not smart enough, they're not good looking enough. Violence exists in the spouse who ignores his wife at home and goes and finds comfort and contentment in someone outside of the home. Violence exists against our own selves when we go against the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we go against the rules of compassion, mawadda wa rahma, that we should maintain between us, between our spouses, between our neighbors, between our friends, between our relatives. And instead we think, I am going to fight violence in society by attending a conference about moderation in Islam, by going to the government, by writing letters, by doing this and this, and yet neglecting to look at our own homes, and neglecting to look at our own selves, and question ourselves, what have I done today to ensure that there is no violence in my home? What have I done today to exhibit mawadda wa rahma, compassion and mercy within my own home? When we look at the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is the epitome of what it means to control anger, who is the epitome of what it means to practice peace in a loving way with all he encountered. When we look at his interactions with his spouses, we will see that that concept of violence, of domestic violence that we see so often in the counseling sector, did not exist. That it's not of our faith. That it is not anchored in any way to our Islam. When Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they had guests or individuals that were meeting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time, one of the other wives of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent a dish that had some food that she had cooked over to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, in that moment of human jealousy, she threw the dish on the floor because she thought it was an insult. She didn't want to see that the other dish of good food that had been cooked. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his response was not, how could you? Why would you throw this dish? Why would you react in that way? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled and looked at his guests and said, Ummina Ghalamat, our mother is exhibiting some jealousy. And he helped her pick up the pieces and he simply told her to get a different dish and eat it back. And this is that rahmah that we see missing today. And I'm not saying, you know, wives go home and break dishes. That's not what this is about. It's about knowing how to interact with one another in a way that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even with the people around him, he consistently exhibited that control, that desire to give da'wah through actions, not just through words. We all, of course, are familiar with the story of the Bedouin, the poor Bedouin who entered the masjid and, you know, did his business. He urinated in the corner of the masjid. And when the Sahaba saw him desecrating the masjid in that way, they became angry and they wanted to yell at him and they wanted to remove him, physically remove him from the place. And they turned to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his reaction was, let him finish. Let him finish. A man who is doing his business in a place where prayer is offered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many times have we seen our youth enter the masjid, maybe in a way that seems inappropriate to us? Maybe they've said a curse word in the masjid. Maybe a young person has entered the masjid, a young woman without her hijab on, with a short skirt on. Maybe a young brother has entered the masjid with many piercings and tattoos. What is our reaction when we see that? Do we encourage them? Do we welcome them? Or do we turn to that violent side? Do we tell them, this is no way for you to enter the masjid? Leave right now and don't come back unless you're appropriate. And what happens? They don't come back. They don't come back because we're not exhibiting that humaniyah, that compassion that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has shown us in his demeanor, his manners. Every time we open the Qur'an, every time we open our salah, every time we begin anything in our lives, we start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to call on Him in everything we do with two of the most beautiful of His names in our lives. And they are two names that both encompass mercy. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rahma. Where is that rahmah in our interactions with each other today? Where is that rahmah in our interactions with our families? Where is that rahmah in how we deal with the world around us? We call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with those names of rahmah. And yet sometimes we forget to exhibit those elements of rahmah in our day-to-day lives. We know the narration, of course, of Sayyidina Ali, who was approached by one of his servants, someone who was working for him. And she had very hot water with him. And as she was heading towards him, the hot water spilled on him, burning him. As he looked towards her, she remembered the verses of Surah Ali Imran. And she repeated the verse in which it states, وَالْقَادِمِينَ الْغَيْبِ وَالْعَفِينَ عَنَ النَّاسِ. Those who suppress their anger, and those who forgive the people. And upon hearing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about the suppressing of the anger, Ali responded and said that he controlled his anger and that he forgave her. for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet so many times in our own homes, we see our children breaking something. We see our children bothering us. We see our spouse doing something that maybe we don't like. Maybe he forgot to take out the garbage. Maybe she went on a shopping spree and spent more than we wanted her to. Maybe our children are not listening, not doing their homework, failing their tests. What is our reaction? Do we remember the ayah from Surah Ali Imran? Are we al-qadimin al-ghayb? Do we control our anger and suppress it? Or do we let it exhibit itself in a way where our home is no longer the safe haven for our spouses and our children, but instead our home is the seat of violence? Because it's a violence that puts our spouses down, that puts our children down, that makes us no better sometimes than those that we see on television committing acts in the name of Islam that we know are not a part of Islam. A relationship that is built in the home upon fear, a relationship that is built in the home upon a feeling that there is no safety, is not of Islam either. That is not in our faith. That is not a following of the Sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now let's say we have all spent this time reflecting, focusing on ourselves, questioning ourselves, ensuring that we are trying to be the best version of ourselves that we can be, and that we have worked on following the advice of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, do not become angry, do not become angry, do not become angry. And we have gotten to that point where we try with our family every day to control our anger and not to allow our home to be the seat of violence. How do we take the next step? How do we echo that feeling of safety and comfort and compassion and care that we have in our family? How do we allow that to enter into the world? How do we engage the world with that face rather than the face that the world seems to expect of us? The face of someone who doesn't smile, the face of someone who's always angry, the face of someone who wants to pick a fight. Of course, we know again that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the example of true social justice. And it's interesting to note that although our history books may not teach our children this in public schools, we know from historical context that the Mayflower Compact, upon which this country was built, upon which the ideals of freedom and society and social justice hinged, is actually based upon the Charter of Medina, Dustur al-Medina, the Charter of Medina that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam composed upon entering Medina. When the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Medina, he entered a place that had been plagued by fighting, a place that had been plagued by violence, a place that had been plagued by all that hurt the people. And when he entered, it became al-Madinatul Munawwara, the city of light. Because he was a light to that city. Because he brought with him the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which were words filled with peace. And just as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Medina and brought into it light, we have to open our hearts and allow the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enter our hearts and fill them with light. Because that light is there. It exists in our Quran. It exists in our Sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we need to open our hearts to it. And so we see that upon entering Medina, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Muhajireen were the strangers. And yet they entered the city and were welcomed with open arms because of the goodness that they brought with them. The Ansar wanted the Muhajireen and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be among them. They wanted that light, they wanted that peace. And what have we done in our country today? Have we exhibited that same peace? Have we brought with us from our own respective countries and cultures and areas that same type of peace and welcoming? Or have we come with the intention to change, as those around us sometimes fear? Not to change ourselves, but to change those around us. Because that's where fear comes from. The fear of someone new coming and taking away that what's familiar, that's what you're used to. And in Medina, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon entering, would tell the Ansar not because the Mujahideen have come in. It didn't have to be everything different. Yes, the elements of the deen, yes, the elements of the faith were there. But if there were cultural differences, they didn't have to be completely changed or deleted. And that the pact of ikhwa, that brotherhood that existed because the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked each of the muhajireen that came with him to become like a brother to one of the Ansar. So that there was like a buddy system that grew between them. And there was a connection of brotherhood that was built between those who were coming and those who were there. And that connection is what led to that feeling of peace, that feeling of mutual respect, that feeling of being one united ummah. And that's the feeling that we're missing in our communities today. Again, we lament the accusations that are hurled at us. We lament the fact that people around us will say, we are this, we are this, we are this. But do we look internally? Can you honestly say that you wish for your brother what you wish for yourself? Or more so than that even? And if we cannot honestly say that, if you cannot look at your brother right now, or look at your sister right now, and say, I wish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer your dua before He answers mine. If we can't do that, then there is something broken in our ummah. Then we are missing that element of brotherhood that will instigate peace within our ummah internally first, and then that peace will ripple externally. We can't focus so much on trying to fix what's outside without first fixing what's inside. So I only have about 2 minutes left, so I want to wrap up what I have to say here. Again, we're looking at the Rasul of Allah and the Sahaba. During the year of sorrow, when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost those who were so close and near and dear to him, he asked for a makhraj. He made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he would receive a sign, something, to help him in his path in working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he received the mawhiba to go to Ta'if and to speak to those in Ta'if about Islam, about La ilaha illallah. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Ta'if with a great deal of hope in his heart that maybe this would be the turning point, that the entrance into Ta'if would allow the people to believe in La ilaha illallah. And we know that as he walked into Ta'if and he met with the leaders there, he was shunned, he was put down, he was discouraged, he was called other names, and he was told to leave. And as he leaved from the city of Ta'if, as he walked 18 miles through the streets of Ta'if, he was pelted with stones, garbage was thrown at him, he was taunted by the children in the riffraff of the town. So much so that when he exited the gates of Ta'if, there was blood coming all over his beloved body.